by Irving Berlin in 1927. The name, putting on Ritz, comes from a slang term for dressing fashion. In the original version, it told of the ritzy airs of Harlemites parading up and down Lenox Avenue. For the 1946 film, the Strutters became well-to-do whites on Park Avenue. The patronizing yet admiring satire of the song shifted and mellowed in the process. The change may have had to do with changing attitudes towards race and with Hollywood's dawning wariness about offending blacks. Regardless, this is a catchy syncopated song that brings out the toe tap. Remember that it was used in Mel Brooks' Young Frankenstein. Everybody remember that one? He's there with the monster. Man about town. Put on the ribs. Well, maybe that was like all. The line, of course, is, and now, ladies and gentlemen, from what was only an inarticulate mass of lifeless tissue, I give you a cultured, sophisticated man about town. Hit it!
Thank you.
born in 1899, he was the son of two pianists. I think the story of his upbringing tells a lot. His mother insisted on surrounding him with dignified women at an early age to reinforce his sense of manners and to teach him to live elegantly. His dapper dress and easy grace gave him a bearing that inspired one of his friends to call him Duke. And that was while he was still in grade school. The name stuck for the rest of his life. Although Duke began taking piano lessons at an early age, he didn't like it. He much preferred baseball. However, his musical tendencies came through, and he wrote his first soda fountain rag at the tender age of 14. And that was before he learned to read music. Duke didn't really develop a liking for piano playing until he began sneaking into a pool room at age 14 and listening to the various settings of piano players there. You know, people like Louis Blake, for instance. That's Waller. He listened and learned and began imitating what he heard. His high school teacher began teaching him harmony and exposure to other legendary ragtime pianists and composers and allowed him to develop his own style and skill. The piece we're going to play was written in 1940 during Ellington's height as a big band director as Never Know Lament. 2 years later, lyrics and a new title were given to the work and it became Don't Get Around Much.
Jackson native, Willard Godfrey Bailey.
His parents ran a photographic outfit in Jackson, and Willard, aka Bill, taught music by day and played trombone and some piano in the saloons at night. The 1900 census had Willard listed as a piano teacher in Jackson. He had married Sarah Sechrist on June 26, 1894. Their happy union seemed quite solid. For perhaps less than a year, Bill enjoyed staying out. And Sarah Sechrist Bailey Williams noted in 1973 at age 100, he was my sweetheart, but he was everybody else's too. It was probably after Bill and Huey discussed enough incidents concerning his understandably indignant wife that Huey used their situation as a template for his iconic Bill Bailey, won't you please come home? It was reportedly penned at one of Cameron's favorite New York City hangouts, one that many musicians frequented, Kid McCoy's Saloon, at the corner of 40th and Broadway. Cannon later maintained that the song was meant to be a joke, one that Sarah Bailey never quite grasped. She later acknowledged that the music was fine, but the words were what lured him. Tragically, Huey became addicted to drugs and alcohol at an early age, and his addiction brought an early end to his life in 1912 from cirrhosis of the liver. He was only 35. The subjects of his song remained happily married and outlived Huey by more than a half century. The song that most people are familiar with omits the verse and starts right into the chorus, and we're going to do the same thing. Bill Bailey.
Thank you.
It's by Percy Weinrich, who was born in Carthage, Missouri, the son of the town postmaster in 1887. His mother was a talented amateur pianist who taught young Percy to play. As a teenager, he acquired some notoriety as a virtuoso pianist known as the Joplin Kid. He soon had several rags published, and around 1907 met a young Broadway performer named Dolly Conway. They were soon married and toured together, with Percy writing the occasional song for her performance. The work we're going to do, the Red Rose Rag, was composed in 1911 and dedicated to her. Weinrich is known by two other works, Put on Your Old Gray Bonnet, and When You Wore a Tulip and I Wore a Big Red Rose. He went on to compose many songs and musicals until his retirement in 1930. I think if you are in, well, you remember the old Tonight Show, when George Burns used to appear on it. He'd very often sing the words to this song. But we're just going to play the Red Rose Rag.
Well, it's 2 o'clock, so I want to welcome you to the atrium. Thank you for coming today. We have the Alder Street Winds sharing music for Woodwind Trio, so let's give them a nice welcome.
Thank you. It's nice to know that our friends and relatives outnumber us. This afternoon, we'll be playing, if you have your programs, and you'll see, playing pieces by several composers that are familiar names to all of us, and then a couple of composers that we'd never heard of before. but whose works we found really exciting, and we'd like you to hear them too. First, a composer who was certainly unfamiliar to all of us, and that's a little surprising. Julius Röntgen was, in his time, one of the best-known European musical figures. He was born in Leipzig in 1855, and born to a musical family. His father was the concertmaster of the Leipzig Gewandhaus Orchestra. His mother was a professional pianist. He had various relatives who were musicians. He was a child prodigy, met the major composers of the time, Brahms, Liszt, and others. Became a professional pianist at age 18, and went on to eventually moved from Germany to the Netherlands, where he was in, he moved to Vienna, to Amsterdam originally, yeah. Chose Amsterdam over Vienna at the time, and was involved in founding the Amsterdam Concertgebouw, where he thought he would be the conductor, and he turned out he got out of it. Didn't get that job, but in his older age, he then really settled down on composing an enormous amount of music. This particular piece was composed, my notes say 1917, and I don't know why they say that. The copyright date is 1931, which is the year before he died, but it's very possible that it was composed in 1917. So at any rate, it is to some extent representative of what was going on or was about to go on. He was somewhat ahead of his time in the European music world. So this is a trio, as it says, for flute, oboe, and bassoon by Julius Röntgen. Thank you.
Thank you. A lot of people are just saying, no, it's good to help yourself to post. on Friday night. But nowadays, you just go to...
No, sometimes it's right. When you live what I'm wearing, nice stuff, people are just like, oh, that's my...
Don't worry, you're not that person.
So he was going to Portland.
Thank you.